and actually read them afterwards. So my philosophy is to give maximum knowledge to people, Amina. So I believe in a different type of approach, Amina. I hope it will be acceptable here.
Every talk is being recorded.
Okay.
Now, Deep Surana, she is the president of executive committee here in JAL.
Jai Jinendra, everyone.
Jai Jinendra.
Should we start recording?
Yes.
Yes.
Just would like to acknowledge everybody who has been joined with us every month for these lectures. This is our sixth lecture, and with connecting with the 100 centenary celebration of Acharya Mahapragyaji. Such an amazing, amazing personality, if we see from the perspective of science, coming from a very small town village. Can you wonder he has never taken an appropriate college education, studied himself, and made a remarkable history in the science? And look what science is taught today. Where are we? We are in the corona situation, although Miami-Dade County and Florida is in phase 3 today. But just wanted to let you guys know that today, what corona has taught us is also part of science. And I cannot even wait today to listen from our amazing, amazing guest speaker. But before I say that, I would like today, I wanted to start something today. In the chat, I would like everybody to put in one word, what positive effect corona has taught you. One word in the chat, what positive effect corona has taught you. Only positive, no negatives today. So in one word, if you can put in chat, and I want everybody to participate, what has corona taught us? I know corona has taught me several things, but in one word, if I would like to put it, jokes apart, but yes, I have started looking into a lot of recipes to make food at home. That I know. So, a lot of you are putting, yes, bringing us together, humility, humanity. And I see in chat that a lot of you have gratitude, appreciation, and I love what you all are putting in. And remember—
For me, it has been creativity.
Thank you, Deepakji. Thank you, Deepakji.
It has made me think creatively that how we need to deal with this world moving forward. So creativity is one thing that I learned through coronavirus.
That is so true. That is so true. We all have learned so many good things. And I am amazed at this lecture series. And every month I talk to Shramniji before the lecture starts. And I'm like, Shramniji, who is our next guest speaker? And the way she has brought all these diamonds from, right now, most of the diamonds are from city of Lakes, Udaipur, which I'm really proud because I am from Udaipur.
Oh,
so,
great.
So, and it's funny that I've never met any of you, never talked about this, but during this corona time, how Shramniji has brought all of us together with JCCF, with the community's help, we are all here. And without further ado, I would like to call Steve Vose, who has been with us for so long. And also he is today an assistant professor at FIU for religious studies. For Jain Studies program that we have, Mahavir Bhagwan Jain Studies program. And he is going to introduce our guest speaker. So let's hear from Steve Wolf.
Oh, thank you very much, Deep Ji. And Jai Jinendra, everyone. And
Jai Jinendra.
It's my distinct pleasure to introduce to you today, Dr. Surendra Singh Pokharna. Before I do that, I just wanted to say a few things about what's going on at FIU this year. We are almost completely online in the religious studies department. So we're teaching online or remotely, either with live sessions or asynchronous. We have a few in-person classes, but for the most part, we're staying put and doing our part for the pandemic here. As far as the lecture series go, it looks like we'll have something lined up in the next few weeks. We had originally planned to have Dr. this book is right here, Shaolin Jain from Delhi University. My background's not showing it. Who is a professor in the history department at Delhi University. Shaolin's book is about Jains in the Mughal period. And he is set to give the possibly 10th, actually, Mahavir Jayanti lecture. And so we'll let you know soon when that will be out. And so right now, because of the pandemic, study abroad programs are shut and things like that. So we're finding new ways to meet each other. And so having this online lecture series that was actually presaged by somebody, Unnata Pragya, many years ago, when she did the live lecture series on the Acharanga Sutra. And so at that point in time, it was just sort of a novelty to have people give talks online. And now we're finding out just how easy and it can be to do these lecture series like this. So I'm very happy to have this lecture series coming up to keep people engaged and thinking about new things. And I think Professor Pokarna's talk is going to be excellent for that. As far as this lecture series about Acharya Mahapragya's birth centenary, it seems fitting that we would do a series of lectures that are connecting science and religion together. It was one of Acharya Mahapragya's main missions, really, as he was bringing the Therapant into the 20th century, the late 20th century, picking up from Acharya Tulsi's leadership. One of the things I've always admired about Acharya Mahapragya's work is how much he really saw the traditional sciences and traditional scholarly techniques of things like philology, translation, working on texts, not as part of a kind of dusty old way of doing scholarship or anything like that, but as really a way to revitalize the tradition and to think about how to bring sort of the timeless information of the Agams into the 20th and 21st centuries as people's language capabilities were changing and adapting and as people's geographic spread was growing ever wider. And so I think that today's talk is especially fitting of seeing just how much the tradition can push science forward to keep thinking and keep going in new directions. So with that, I just want to introduce Dr. Pokarna. So Dr. Surendra Singh Pokarna is a PhD in physics, holds a postdoctoral degree in biophysics, and has done postgraduate diploma in operations research. He was a lecturer and assistant professor of physics at two colleges in Rajasthan and Chennai, and at the Udaipur University of course, Udaipur. He was a scientist at the ISRO, that's NASA India, for 19 years, and was also a chief operating officer at high-tech outsourcing services for 7. In the last 3 years, he's started the Science and Spirituality Research Institute in Ahmedabad to initiate multidisciplinary research on science, Jainism, and Indian culture, among other things. He has around 150 publications, including scientific notes, technical notes, papers in national and international journals, articles in newspapers and magazines in such fields as physics, operations research, general systems theory, remote sensing, sustainable development, Indian culture, parapsychology, spirituality, and to our talk today, Jainism. And I just wanted to share with you the link to Professor Pokarna's blog if you haven't had the chance to check it out yet. I'm just putting the link right here in the chat to everyone. I was just perusing some of his work, including his most recent entry there, which is The Exploration of General Systems Theory, GST, and Jainism, which may provide new frontiers of knowledge and evolution. And having gone through that, I think that'll be at least part of the gist of the talk today from Professor Pokarna. And with that, I will let him get to it. And so it's my pleasure to welcome and introduce to you Professor Surendra Singh Pokarna.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Walsh. I am very grateful to Samnidhi for inviting me for this very prestigious lecture series. I really feel very happy and very honored to be a part of this lecture series. I have some very interesting, some kind of connection with Therapant Samaj. We are basically actually from Barapant Samaj, that is our Guru Vach Acharya Nana Lalji Maharaj Sahib, but my relative, that is my father's sister, we call it Bhua, She was from Therapan Samaj and she didn't have any issue actually. So from early childhood, we used to go to her house every day. And there we used to see actually many this sadhu and sadhvis of the Therapan Samaj. So there we used to compare the two actually from our this Sthanakvasi Samaj and Therapan Samaj and so on. Now as I grew further, then I actually, and when I was doing my PhD, then in 1975, a very interesting thing took place. A first conference on science and Jainism was organized by Therapan Samaj in Jaipur, 1975. And it was at the initiative of Acharya Tulsi. And Mr. Mahavir Gelda was the person who organized this conference. Now there, I was also invited. I also sent a paper, and that paper was accepted, and I was just presenting it in front of Acharya Tulsi. Now, you will not believe that I was trying to compare the karma theory with my PhD topic of liquid helium, that what is known as quantum field theory, which is used now and now becoming very popular in to study consciousness. So that paper I presented in 1975. Now, after listening to my paper, Acharya Tulsi called me near him. And as a young boy, actually, I just rushed towards him. And then he said, he told me, actually, I was very near to his face. And he told me that, "Is kaam ko aage badhana hai." So that became a very, very powerful driving force for me to do this type of studies. I mean, now. Then there is another incident directly related with Acharya Mahapragyaji. I had his darshan in, I don't know the year, but there is a place called Nathadwara near Udaipur. And there I went to just have his darshan. And it was around 5 o'clock in the evening. And most of the sadhu sadhvis were preparing for gochri. So I went there and introduced myself. And I said, "I am scientist from ISRO and I am working on science and Jainism." He was very happy indeed. He said, and that I should speak something about what I am doing. And at that time, he invited all the sadhu sadhvis and shravak shravikas to just sit there. And he gave me 10 minutes to speak about what I was doing. So I explained them. He was very happy about that. So those, the happiness and those type of encouragement and motivation by these great acharyas play an extremely important role in taking up such challenging activities. Then there is another very interesting thing, what great people they are. I want to give another example. My brother-in-law, his daughter, her name is Divya. She was actually learning a course on photography. So she had very big and very powerful cameras. So she had visited Acharya Mahapragyaji and she requested Acharya Mahapragyaji to have his photographs in her camera. Now, those cameras were very costly. They were costing about 2 lakh rupees and 3 lakh rupees and something like that. We are having very finer adjustment capabilities. Now, that girl, she found it very challenging. She could not focus those cameras on face of Mahapragyaji because there was some radiation coming from his face. And she told me afterward that she had never faced this type of problem in taking any photograph. Now, what type of radiation is coming from these great people? It was there, I think, in Acharya Tulsi also, very clearly visible. There is something which is of great interest to scientists. So with these initial remarks, I will just try to start with my slides and why this scientist should take now interest in Jainism. I will just start with my slides now. So, I mean, the title of my presentation is Limitation of Scientific Knowledge and Depth of Spiritual Knowledge. I mean, as I told you, I am associated with Science and Spirituality Research Institute, and I am now really grateful to Jain Education and Research Foundation, Jain Center of South Florida, Department of Religious Studies, Florida International University, and Stephen J. Green School of International and Public Affairs for really inviting me to make this presentation. Now, I mean, as I told you, I dedicate this paper to these four great personalities. On the left are my parents, and on the right are my this Bua and Phupaji. They were from Therapan Samaj, and we were from the Sthanakwasi Samaj. But that union that brought in many new ideas, many new things. So I dedicate it to them, and I also dedicate it to Acharya Tulsi, Acharya Mahaprajnaji, and Acharya Mahasramanji. I was associated with Acharya Mahasramanji also when we have organized one conference on science and Jainism in, I think, 2014 in Delhi. So I'm just, I mean, I dedicate this paper to this great, great, great souls. Now, in the summary, I say we talk of science and there is a lot of excitement about science, scientific discoveries, and what is happening in the field of science and all these things. But has the time come to critically examine the methodology of science itself, whether it can really describe the truth? So then, does science provide only partial truth and partial knowledge of reality, or it can provide complete truth or total description of the reality it can provide? This is a question to be asked. Do recent advances in science indicates a need for searching some alternative system of understanding this reality? Then now it is a very serious problem now that many scientists are recognizing that consciousness is required in science from different perspectives. To hardcore science now, we cannot proceed further unless we incorporate consciousness now into our methodology of describing the reality. A very interesting nine-dimensional theory of everything has been developed by two American scientists, which can integrate all the branches of knowledge. It is not just like unifying all the four forces of nature, like electromagnetic field, nuclear forces, and weak interaction and gravitational force, but they are trying to unify all the disciplines, that is physics, chemistry, mathematics, psychology, social studies, science, and everything that you can think of. So that model which they have developed, you will be surprised that it is very close to Jainism. I have identified and I am working with them, and there are 15 parameters which are common in Jainism, which are there in that theory also. So that is the direction now in which we are going actually. Now, what science has given us? Science has given us this mobile. It has given us extremely good medical facilities. It has provided a satellite and rocket and all these tall buildings can be built up now, and several hundred things science has provided us. So we are feel very proud of science and all these things. But a critical examination is required. Now, what is happening in the current world? Population is increasing and resources are shrinking. Automation, computerization is increasing, but jobs are decreasing. Sperm counts in males have gone down by 50% in last 50 years. There is a very, very serious, and it is there in the whole world. So studies have shown this thing, and it's a very serious matter. The females are behaving like males. Now, this is another trend which is now actually developing. So the difference between the two is decreasing actually. Now, only few years are left to reverse the irreversible changes which are taking place in the climate. It will become very difficult even if we take action now. Then people are becoming more self-centered and interaction among them is decreasing. Everybody is so busy, they don't have time to talk to others or interact with others. Then development is interpreted in the economic materialistic sense only. Can there be other directions of development like spiritual development? And that spiritual development, can it be different from the economic development? Now, Acharya Mahaprajnaji gave an idea of relative development or relative economics. Now, that is very relevant in the current era, in the present era, as I will try to describe further. Now, in the field of ecology, what is happening? We are losing more than 25,000 biological species every year. which is a lot faster than we are discovering new ones. Then 150 billion animals are slaughtered every year for food. What effect do they have on climate? Is it unimaginable? I mean, then half of the animals in the world have disappeared since 1970. And that number is in lakhs and lakhs and lakhs of these billions. A very huge number. I mean, so almost the entire decline is due to human activity. And on the right side, I have shown a graph. It shows that Earth is now moving towards sixth extinction. Now, sixth extinction means in last 550 million years, only five extinctions have taken place, in which a very significant portion of the living being disappeared from the Earth. But now we are moving toward the sixth one, and this will be human-made. And will science and concept of economic development will be responsible for this type of catastrophe? That has to be examined very, very seriously and critically and honestly. Sorry. Now, science can create many wonderful things. Now, here you see that mobile I have seen, a satellite I have shown, then a train also has been shown. They are all great wonders. Then on the right, I have shown you the rocket. It is being launched in ISRO. It was a common thing, and we used to launch rockets. And on the bottom, you can see the Google network. That is the Google network at the bottom. Now, science has given all these things. Now, when I was actually working in ISRO, then our colleague used to launch the rockets. Now, everybody used to look at the trajectory of the rocket, whether it is going in the proper direction or not. So I was also used to, I also was looking at that itself, that is the rocket, but I was also looking at the other side of the rocket, that is the gases, hot gases, which were coming out from the rocket. Now, being a Jain, I was taught in the early childhood that air also has some kind of jeev, some kind of living body. They call it vayukaya. Now, I used to think how many vayukayas are getting killed by launching of a rocket. Can any scientist answer this question? And I asked it to many scientists. They used to laugh at me that what nonsense question I am asking. But that is not a nonsense question. It is a question which is very, very important. And on the right side, I have shown that science has created so many things. But science is not able to produce an ant. It is not able to produce even a blade of grass. So these are the very, very serious problems about science. On the one hand, science is responsible for causing death of so many living beings on the earth. And on the other hand, the current science is not able to produce any living being. It's a very, very serious matter. Oh, sorry. Now, here you see that what is happening in the name of development. We, through science, we have developed technologies, the mechanical engineering, chemical engineering, electrical engineering, civil engineering, and so on the right side, you can see. And on the green, actually on the left side, you can see greenery and soil, small living beings, very many different types, and water and air and all these things. Now, in all this process of this development, we are losing greenery, we are losing soil, we are killing insects, and we are polluting the water. And so what we are generating basically is what is known as now non-biological order. That is, all these big machines, all these tall buildings, all the industries, they don't have any life. They are not living beings. But we are destroying the living beings and the life support system and creating those things. Now, this is a fundamental question now, that in which direction we are going. What is the meaning of development now? This needs to be now very, very critically examined. Now, there's another thing now, that there is a disorder is increasing in our atmosphere in all walks of life. All sort of pollutions are there, Malav. Now, what is happening is that petrol, diesel, and several metals are basically confined to a small volume in the earth, which I have shown by green, circle. And on the right side, I have seen that petrol, diesel, and metals have entered into the atmosphere or the earth. So they have expanded, they have spread. Now, that means that disorder is increasing, entropy is increasing, entropy is a technical word. What is happening is that we are extracting these things and spreading them into the whole thing. And this is what we are calling as development. So this again has to be examined. So now, but on the other hand, for life processes, we require order. So order, and in the helical, this DNA, which has helical structure, has some kind of order. An electron moving around a proton or a nucleus has some kind of order. It is moving in circle. Earth moving around sun, for example, it has some periodicity, some kind of order. Now, this order is reflected in temples, for example, at the roof of the temple, for example. Now, this is there in all our biological cycles, which are there in our body. So this is also a type of order which is repeated. And a woman having mehndi, for example, there also has some order or symmetry. Now, this order or symmetry is becoming very, very significant, but not much attention is being paid. We are slowly and slowly destroying this symmetry and order also in the name of economic development. Now, what is happening toward this economic development? As I told you in the previous slide that we are producing non-renewable resources. Now, there are 500 Fortune companies in the world, and there are around 6,000 companies whose shares are listed in the Indian share market. Now, a majority of these companies who are, say they are very rich people who are associated with these companies, a majority of them, that is around 80%, are based on non-renewable resources. Whereas the modern concept of development is linked with economic development, so therefore it needs to be critically examined that the whole concept of economic development, majority of it is linked with non-renewable resources. Now, please note that in the past, that is in the olden days, the entropy was, economy was based on renewable resources, that is a person, how many animals he has, how much land he has, how much this crop he is producing, and that was the criterion. So it was based on renewable resources. And now the modern economy is based on the non-renewable resources. There's a fundamental difference, and all this we are just generating by this scientific advancement, technology development, and all these things. So again, we have to examine. Then another culprit, I would call it culprit, a strong word I am using, is Darwin principle of evolution. Now, there are two scientists, Professor Daniel Dennett and Professor Edward Goldsmith, great scientists they are. They are challenging the foundation of Darwin principle. And they say that it needs to be critically examined. Now, when we say that Darwin principle, it is expressed by what is known as survival of fittest. But in Jainism and in other religions, we talk about live and let live. So these are two different principles. So a person should follow this principle or that principle, or the reality is between the two. So when we talk of this survival of fittest, it is based on physical reality. Whereas the principle of live and let live is based on spiritual reality. Survival of fittest is based on emphasis on differences in species, whereas live and let live principle is based on underlying identity. Then survival of fittest results into unwanted competition. Live and let live leads to cooperation. Then society has been damaged due to the Darwin principle. It is now expressed by many scientists openly on many platforms. But due to spiritual development, society gets enlightenment. Now, in the case of the survival of fittest, there is no goal. What we are, why we are surviving, what is the objective of our life? It is not clearly, it is not mentioned at all. But in the field of spiritual development, there is a definite goal, that is to achieve moksha. That is something great idea. Then in the race of the survival of fittest, resources are misused. But in the case of this principle, if somebody is following this principle of live and let live, then resources are spiritually used. So they are used with control. That again, a very fundamental difference. So that again needs to be critically examined. I mean, now, science is very good for studying the physical system, but when we study the biological systems or human system using science, then there are many problems. So biological systems are essentially irreversible in nature. That is, they grow and decay. They are also open system compared to the physical systems or closed system. They are open in the sense that, for example, we are taking oxygen and we are releasing carbon dioxide, for example. So we are open system constantly interacting with the surroundings. In addition, human systems have memory which makes it impossible to do any strictly defined scientific experiment on them. It cannot be done, basically, theoretically, I mean, in principle. Hence, biological and social systems cannot be subjected to the process of measurement, and hence they are not exactly describable in the strict terminology of the physical science, that is the space-time invariance condition of science, which is there to study the physical system. So a new discipline known as gender system theory has developed to handle such system. But we have to go even beyond that. This is also not sufficient. Oh, sorry. Okay, so now there's another issue that need to realize that scientific knowledge is only a subset of the total knowledge system. Scientific knowledge is defined through physics as severe limitations due to the definition of conservation laws itself, because they are defined for closed systems. And there are errors, statistical errors, which may be very large. Actually, the recent development in computer science and neurobiology clearly show that knowledge is nothing but information organized in some way. And in turn, information is nothing but organization of data in some fashion. And consciousness, which is there in animals now, that can also do this type of information gathering and knowledge generation. It is possible, Amina. So all living beings also have a concept of knowledge. So that needs to be actually recognized. Now, here are some examples. The Christ is there, Lord Krishna is there, Mirabai is there, then Maharana Pratap and Gandhiji and Muhammad Rafi. Now, all of these, they were not scientists, but they were not following, they might be following some kind of scientific logic. But what it means is that they had different way of thinking. So that means that there are areas which need not fall into the domain of science, but they are truth. They are falling into the domain of truth. So what we say is, for example, knowledge of history is there, geography, Vedas, Agamas, Bible, philosophy, music, arts, spirituality. They are not falling into the domain of science. There is a misconception in the society that science is ultimate and science is everything and all that. It is not correct this to be recognized and realized. So scientific knowledge is a small subset of the total knowledge system. It is just a tip of the iceberg, which I have shown on the right side. Then there's another problem with science, what we call as reductionist approach. The reductionist approach means that when we look at something, we try to divide it into parts, divide further, so on, till we get this, what we call as molecules and atoms and electrons, protons, and further quarks and like that. But there is another way to go. That is, we look at the whole thing in totality. Then we call it wholeness. That is, we go in the reverse direction from quark to neutron, proton, then atom, then molecule, then matter, earth, solar system, Akash, Ganga, universe, and so on. So if we go in this direction, then we require some different type of approach, what is known as wholeness. It is being now recognized within scientific community also as emergentism. So something comes out from the small system that is called emergentism, I mean. But it is very clearly mentioned in Jainism that we require both wholeness as well as reductionism to understand the total reality, total truth. And for example, in this case, you can see we have hydrogen and for example, say oxygen, which constitute water. Now, water has properties which are not there in hydrogen or oxygen, except for mass and so on, charge and those particles and all those stuff. So, wholeness means something comes out by interaction of the two. Now, this wholeness is not there in the individual parts. So, something comes out new, that is very important. So, we have to talk about both reductionism and wholeness together to understand the reality. And in Jainism, there is profound literature about it, I can say without any doubt, I mean, that they emphasize on this total. And Anekandvad particularly, or Nayavad in general, I would say, they extensively talk about these different ways of describing the truth. No need to get confined only to the reductionist approach of science. And you see the beauty of the whole thing is that they have developed a language system such that wholeness and reductionism are described together. That is, for example, Tattva Sutra, they are talking of, say, Jeev, Achiv, Ashrav, Ban, Savar, Nirjara, and Moksh. Now, here you can see that they have written a Jiva, Jivashrav, Band, Savar, Nirjara, Moksha, Stuvam. Now, here you can see that whole these nine words, these eight words are divided into just two big cluster of words. This cluster of words describe the wholeness. That is a very profound thing. That is that your language also has to be like that. And we have to appreciate this language, and it is there in Sanskrit and Prakrit. Absolutely, I mean, great thing I have seen. Many sentences consist of about 8, 10, 12, 13, 14, 15, up to 20, 30 words subset. And they are all joined together in a big line. So we have to recognize that thing of looking at the reality in totality. That is a very important concept. Now, again, important concept is that when we are talking of the natural resources and scientific experiments or all these things, we can see some of the things are visible, but some of the things are not visible. But we cannot say that those which are not visible are not important. They are also equally important, but not much thought is actually given to this invisible process. But Jainism talk about both visible as well as invisible. So what we get is where we get lost in visible only and we forget the invisible. So they call it Maya. So what we need is a process-based thinking, a system-based thinking is required when we look at the reality in totality. That is specifically highlighted in many agmas and particularly the literature which I am reading these days. So it is absolutely fascinating. Then there is another way, why we need consciousness. Now here I have tried to explain that we have Einstein who gave the idea of E is equal to mc square. I have shown his photograph on left side. Now when he was trying to do this research, he was basically a religious person. What was there in his mind? What was the state of his consciousness? He was trying to understand the nature of reality, that how natural laws behave, what are the natural laws. That was his objective. But when E is equal to mc square was discovered, then there were politicians and there was a situation like that in the world, what we call in Jainism as Desh Kal Bhav. So the situation was thing that Japan was not surrendering. So to teach Japan a lesson, politicians, the members of other group, they thought that let us use this E is equal to mc square to make atom bombs. And so atom bombs were made, they were thrown on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and hundreds, thousands and lakhs of people died, and many are still suffering. So what is the state of our mind? That is very, very important. So we have to understand what is going on inside. That is very, very important indeed. I mean, we just cannot ignore that frontier. I mean, we just cannot ignore. Now, there's another problem. When we do this scientific experiment, you can see that I have drawn four ellipses here. So this first is just talking about scientific experiment, is representing scientific experiment. Second is technology development. Third is economic exploitation. And fourth is the environmental degradation. Now, what is happening is that I call scientific experiment as truth A, technology development as truth B, and economic exploitation as truth C, and environmental degradation as truth D. Now, all of the four are truths, but they are individual. They are, a person who is scientist, he is not concerned with what the technologists will do. I mean, the technologist, he will never know what will be the use of this technology and who will be benefited. So, industrialists or multinational companies or like that. And what it will lead to environmental degradation, economist is also not much concerned about that. But what is needed now is we have to combine all these things and develop the scenario which talk about an integrated approach, that is, we combine all of them together. And this is beautifully described in Jainism through what is known as Sangraha Naya. Sangraha Naya means you look at the reality in totality. So that is the need of the hour now. Now, as I told you, in this particular diagram, there is no direction. What is the objective of all these things that we are doing? There is no goal. There is no goal in this whole methodology, or nobody talks about this. So there, if we compare it with, for example, in Indian culture or this system, then they call dharma, earth, kama, and moksha. So moksha is the objective. Moksha is the goal which has to be achieved. And the foundation on which all our this world should move, it should be dharma. So dharma should be foundation, and earth and kaam should be in between. They should be squeezed between dharma and moksha. That should be the philosophy. Then you will have control over earth and kaam. But here now, everybody is talking about economic development. Nobody is concerned about environment. It is very difficult for all the countries of the world to take any proper, effectively implemented decision which can be followed by public in large. Nobody is following the laws of environment. They know that we are moving toward disaster. So this is the reason why we are. There is no goal in the modern whole phenomenology of science, technology, development, and all this scenario. I mean, so that is a big thing, and we can learn a lot from this concept. Now, the problem with current science is it is very successful in explaining many physical or materialistic phenomena. As I told you, maybe 90%. However, there are many problems in the science, and there are many phenomena which are there, which are true, but the modern science is not able to explain them, and we can't ignore them. Many scientists ignore them. They say it is unscientific, therefore it is meaningless. I don't agree with that. There are many scientists now who are saying that there are processes, there are phenomena which have to be examined very, very thoroughly and critically. And if needed, we have to change the science. We have to extend the science. Now, I will not go into the detail. There are, little difficult. Most of the physics, which is the foundation of science, has three major classes: classical physics, quantum physics, and theory of relativity. Now, there are many inconsistencies when we try to combine the three. Then there are, the scope of action is a broad range, where at subatomic and atomic levels, molecular level, and theory of relativity talks about the whole universe and the large scale processes. So there are inconsistencies. Then in the quantum physics, we have uncertainty principle, wave particle duality, expansion of the universe, and what existed before the Big Bang, or the Darwin principle, evolution. These are some of the problems or areas where satisfactory answers are not available. Now, it is said that scientific science is objective. It is objective way to understand science, but it is really so? Now, many scientists are raising question against this. So relativity theory, for example, we talk about two observers. Now, nobody wants to describe the properties of the observers. They just talk in some kind of imagination that there are two observers and they are moving with respect to each other and all those things and distance. That is not correct. The second is in quantum physics. In quantum physics, an electron or a photon can act both as wave as well as a particle. Now, there what is happening is that again, there is no objectivity. It all depends upon what type of behavior we want from electron or this photon. It could be wave or particles. It is again not objective. It is more or less subjective.
Now, there is another.
I will just go to this some interesting. Please stop this. Now here you see that Satavdhan is a concept which is very common among many these acharyas and many sadhus. They have this faculty. Now how do you explain this? A person can answer three or four statement or events or questions at a time in a proper sequence. If somebody does good practice, then he can go up to 10 to 11. But a Satavdhani can store information about 100 activities, and then he can answer them in the same sequence, reverse sequence, or at random in any sequence. Now, how does you develop this type of state of consciousness? Now, there is an example that, Mahatma Gandhi learned this type of thing, the Ahimsa, from Srimad Raj Chandji. He was a Satavdhani. He has that properties of Satavdhani. Now, how do we understand Satavdhani in the modern science? What is that state of mental which leads to this type of situation? Now, here, right now, we have one Ajay Chandji Balasaab, this Ajit Sagarji Marasaab, he's a Mahasatavdhani. He can store information about 500 activities in his brain, and I can recall them in the same sequence, in the reverse sequence, or randomly you ask him any questions, he will be able to tell it. Now, how spiritually you develop this type of control? Now, how do we explain that thing? I mean, it is a big, big challenge to science, and the process required to have this type of faculty. This is a very big thing, actually, and which needs to be understood. And actually, these are some of the activities which are associated with this process of Shatavdhan. And there's another problem now. I mean, this gentleman, Mr. Prahlad Bhai Jani, who expired recently, he was staying near Ahmedabad. He didn't take food and water from last 75 years. Please note it down, 75 years, not months. Now, this is a big challenge to science. And actually, one of my friend, Dr. Sudhir Shah, who made a presentation in this conference also, he did experiment on him, I studied him, and he found that it is correct. There are many such examples. So this is a big challenge to the current science. And we cannot say that it is unscientific, therefore it is wrong. No, we cannot do that thing. We have to keep our mind open and study it, that there is something which is there beyond the current science. Then there is a woman, her name was Bhuri Bhai, and she was staying in Nathadwara. And the man sitting on the right side is Acharya Rajneesh. Now in 1928, this lady has developed what is known as the Atma Gyan. Atma Gyan means she, without reading any book, she will be able to tell you that what is written in the book. And she was tested by many persons and it was found to be correct. Now, what is that thing? So the concept of Atma Gyan is something very profound and very important. Similarly, the example of Ramanujan. It is said that he is a deity. She used to help him in providing solutions to many scientific issues. Now, how this whole thing works? We also, in our Jainism, we talk of Devi Devtas, for example. Scientists ignore them, but I take them seriously. They are there, but we do not know much about them. Then similarly, there is an example here that in the Indo-Pak War, Pakistan attacked one temple in India. The name of the temple was the Tanoj Mata Temple. Now, they threw about 3,000 bombs on that temple, but it could not be destroyed. And I have read the history of this temple, and I found that there was a deity about 1,000 years ago. And she has defined some area. Under that area, nothing will happen. Now, what is that thing? Now, there is another interesting problem with science. Here you see that there are sweets are there. Two different types of sweets are there, Rasgulla and Gulab Jamun. Now there are four Rasgullas and four Gulab Jamun. Now we say that 4 + 4 = 8. But if I say that 4 is Rasgulla and 4 is Gulab Jamun, then what happens to the mathematics? Now this looks like a simple problem, but it is a very complex problem. And that has led to what is known as Godel's incompleteness theorem. And this Godel's incompleteness theorem says that using any language, any mathematics, or any terminology, we cannot describe the truth. Actual reality is much more complex than what this simple mathematics can describe, and we need consciousness to understand that total truth, the actual truth, which is very common, very, very, I would say, close to the concept of Jainism, that knowledge is structured in the consciousness. So I will go now a little quickly because time allotted is less. So now here you see that in Jainism, they talk of a pure consciousness and consciousness which is connected with karmas and material particles, for example. And they talk of this infinite knowledge, infinite intuition, infinite bliss, and infinite power. So they talk of infinite. But in science, we talk of only finite. So that is also a big issue. So that they say that a pure soul has this four infinities. So that is a very profound thing, what it is, I mean. Right now we say that, I mean, Google is a storehouse of knowledge, for example. Okay, or so on and so forth. Or say the YouTube, for example, but it is all finite, I mean. So that is the, Then, I mean, in Jainism, they define five type of knowledges. That is Mati Gyan, Shrut Gyan, then Avdi Gyan, and Man Parya Gyan. Now, in the modern science, the materialistic science, hardcore scientists, they don't believe in Avdi Gyan or clairvoyance and this telepathy. But there are scientists now who believe that, yes, it is a fact and it is not explainable by the current science. So now the question is, it is the fight, I would call it, between finite and infinite. The science, the knowledge of science is finite, whereas knowledge of Atma is infinite. So what is the difference between the two? What will be their implication? In my opinion, implications will be huge. And that needs to be now closely examined. Then there are, in Jainism, they define six different type of clairvoyance. I have given their names in the on that first line, but there is a special type of avdhigyan that is known as Vardhaman avdhigyan. And this Vardhaman avdhigyan is such that one can look at the smallest size of Akasha, or what is known as Pradesha, for example. So through that, and one can see also the whole universe through this Vardhaman now. Now, what is the evidence of this? So, now again, these are three examples from my personal life, which has shown that extrasensory perception exists. It cannot be proved wrong. So science here has to be examined further to incorporate extrasensory perception into the terminology of the science. So now, and these are some of the parapsychic processes which are being recognized. They are well established. I will not go into the details of them, but they are established now with the accuracy of this 1 out of 1 billion as a chance. So these are all well-established parapsychic processes, but most of them are not explainable using the current science. Now, we cannot say that these are wrong. What we have to say now is that science needs to be updated. Science has a limitation. And these are some of the scientists who say that consciousness is required to update the science now. So Wigner, Josephson, Prigozhin, Asimov, Penrose, David Bohm, E.C.G. Sudarshan, and many others. And now, what is the proof of that? This Vardhaman Avdhigyan, here I have just tried to provide a proof that this is the table of measurement of length, which is found in Bhagavati Sutra and Triloy Parnati. And they start from infinitely many Parmanus. And there are relations just like decimal system. They used to have the octal system. And here you see that they call it 8 yava. This 8 yava is equal to 1 angula. Now, if you compute the size of, if you take the size of angula as just 2 centimeter and just try to find out the size of this avsanna sanna skan, then you get a value around 2.9 into 10 to the power of minus 11 centimeter. That is the value you get. That 2 centimeter is equal to 8 to the power 12. So the size of this skanda will be 2.9 into 10 to the power minus 11 centimeter. That is between the size of the atom 10 to the power minus 8 centimeter and 10 to the power minus 13 centimeter. Now, what it means? It means that through avdhigyan, or through what knowledge of Atma, what is called as the pratyaksha gyan and paroksha gyan. So pratyaksha gyan might be developed to such an extent that one can see even the atoms and nuclei, our ancestor acharyas might have seen it. Now, this we have found an independent evidence from the work of any Vicent. And this is a very, very important work. And any Vicent about 100 years ago, she tried to study the structure of atoms using what is known as anima siddhi. So she developed a very extraordinary faculty of clairvoyance, and using clairvoyance, she tried to study these 92 atoms. And if you look here, then what has been found is that, this is the ordinary hydrogen atom where electron is moving around the proton. But what she had seen is these 6 big spheres. These three forming a triangle, and these three forming triangle, and each sphere has small sphere, 3 in each of them. So there are 18 small spheres in the hydrogen atom. Now, nobody took this work seriously except for one English scientist, Stephen Phillips. He said that this contains some mystery. And he was a PhD in particle physics from California University. And he took this very seriously and examined it. He wrote a book also. But we have examined this also further in great detail using new theory, the 9-dimensional science of Nape and Close. And we have found that both these 18 spheres actually represent are parts of quarks. Quarks are known as the smallest particles of proton and neutron. And these are the parts of quarks now. So these are something new, and for 92 elements, these structures are available. And we drew a line between these two, and we have found a straight line. it means there is a very strong possibility that through your what is known as pratyaksha jnan of soul, you can have a look at, you can look at directly quarks also. Now, I don't want to make tall claims, but it shows that something great is there in our ancient shastras and atma. And for that, we are talking about what is known as the this gunasthana or this the development. So we are talking of development in this context now. How to achieve moksha, for example, through 14 stages, 14 sthanas. So this must be also taken very seriously in this context. Now, I mean, but the actually, as I told you, this is there in Hindi, excuse me. So here we are talking of this physical development and spiritual development. So what is the relation between the two? It is very similar to the Darwin's principle and the spiritual principle. So I will not go into the detail. But here are some of the attempts which are made now in science also to understand consciousness. They are talking of brain and they talk of neuron and they talk further the structure of neuron known as microtubules. And this microtubule consists of the still smaller particles known as tubulins. And this tubulin act as a quantum mechanical system. So using this, a theory is becoming very popular. It is called Hemroff and Penrose model. And they say there's a quantum computer-like entity there in our brain, so which can have huge information. But that is, again, not sufficient. So we have to go still further. So now we have to involve quantum physics now to understand consciousness. Many attempts are going on in this direction. So that is the point. Then there is what is known as quantum gravity. It is a very interesting development that... and it is mentioned in Jainism also that as you go deeper, 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 then you get a different type of reality. Now here people are trying to combine the theory of relativity with quantum physics, and they say that if you combine the two, then the space-time geometry, which was put forward by Einstein, for example, if it combined with the concept of quantum physics, then you get what is known as quantized space-time geometry. And that is at the level of 10 to the power minus 35 centimeter and 10 to the power minus 43 second. It is extremely small, extremely small. That has what is known as a spin form. And that spin form can contain huge, huge information, huge information. So now a theory is coming up that this can explain the concept of consciousness or what is called a soul. And it can also explain the theory of pap and punya. And actually such things, because whatever we are doing, that our information is stored in our space-time geometry. And even if we are not there, our space-time geometry will be there. And from there, one can actually, next birth will be decided by that space-time geometry. So I will again not go. And this is the space-time geometry on the right side, which I mentioned, is linked with the human brain. There is a continuous exchange of the data is going on between the two. So theory of pap and punya can be explained, life after life can be explained, and theory of karmas can be also explained using this type. So what I want to say is that many Western scholars are taking some of these things very seriously. We should also take up these things very seriously. And as far as the modern science is concerned, two books have actually come out recently. They are talking about the limitations of science. The first is this by Deepak Chopra, You Are the Universe. And second is this Science Set Free by this Rupert Sheldrake. And they are telling that the current science has stringent limitations. There is a need to go beyond that. Now, so science and sadhva, now I have tried to explain. So just like this, the sevenfold method of judgment, which was sadhva. So maybe science provides truth of reality. Maybe science does provide truth. Actually, this doesn't provide truth of reality. Maybe science provides truth and also does not provide truth of reality and so on. Therefore, science should be examined now from this point of view and from the point of view of Nayavad, actually. So science could be explained only one type of Nay. So, there is a need to go to these others also. So I will not go into the details of this. This is the nine-dimensional model, which was developed by the two American scientists, which I mentioned you. They are talking of a term known as distinction. And actually this triadic means three. And the dimension means dimension, as you know, space and time, and these are the dimensions. And then they have used the term distinction. Distinction means to distinguish two things. So we talk of Paryaya, for example, Anant Paryaya we are talking, for example. So they are also talking of something like Paryaya. Now this vertical, for example, vertical is just like complex vibrations of atoms or maybe some soul or something like that. So, I mean, this also they are talking. So I will just take 5 minutes more. And using this, they have developed what is known as theory of everything. And they have included all branches of science because the distinction is a term which is there in all the discipline. All the disciplines which will have this thing. So this has been explained. And they are talking of three dimensions of space, three dimensions of time. So this is a very interesting and new thing, three dimensions of time. It is different from the physical time, two additional dimensions of time. And then three dimensions of consciousness. They have defined consciousness in a mathematical way. And then what they have found is that they have developed a new mathematics known as calculus of distinction. And they get a figure of 108 in their in the whole mathematical formulation, again and again at many places. And they also say that finite reality is embedded into an infinite reality. Now, this is very much close to the concept of Jainism. I will not go again into detail, but they are talking about consciousness. It has to be non-physical and it has to be, it should have infinite information. They have arrived with the modern logic and modern physics, and this is very close to Jainism. So I will just try to give you concluding remark that there is a TDVP, they call it TDVP model, and here is Jainism. So about 15 factors are there, which are there in their model. Actually, when I met for the first time and I read their work, I told them that what you are talking is there mostly in Jainism. So they felt very angry actually. And they just told me that they are working in this field from last several years, 10 years. And I am telling that it is already there in Jainism. So they felt very bad actually about it. But then afterwards I told them that you should feel happy that your theory is being supported by somebody. I mean, then they were very happy, and then we wrote some papers also. So these are the things. I will not again go into the details because this time is almost coming to end. But you can see that there is no God in their theory. There is no God in Jainism. Finite universe is discrete, but an infinite one embeds it. Finite lokakas has infinite alokakas are around the same. Space is discrete. Akash is discrete. Pradeshas, for example. Clairvoyance and telepathy can be explained using TDVP model of the Gyan and this. And the man pariyaya gyan can be explained. Concept of distinction is common in all fields. Concept of pariyaya is common in all fields everywhere. Consciousness is different from matter and energy. Here also jivastika is different from matter pudgal. Consciousness is non-local and has infinite information. In Jainism also consciousness similar properties. Then similarly, vertical motions are there for objects in different dimensions. And this the Parmanus have different motions, for example. The consciousness associated with all types of matter, prathvikaya, vayukaya, apkaya, agnikaya, they also have some kind of this property of living systems. Actually, it comes out from their models also. Then they talk of what is known as Gimel, a new substance which is non-physical. But mathematically, it is required in their model. And that might be, we are still working on that. Dharmastika and Adharmastika might be linked with that Gimel, for example. We are still examining, we don't know. But actually they were feeling very happy that when they actually heard about the Dharmastika and Adharmastika. And then evolution of consciousness is possible and different from Darwin's principle. This is what their theory says, and Jainism also talks about this only. As one evolves, entropy builds. They talk of order. So order develops actually as one evolves. Now, the same thing, we also talk about that, as we go up through Gunasthanas, then our knowledge level increases. Similarly, matter can be associated with consciousness. This Karman, Vekriya, Arak, and this five type of physical bodies which are there, and the whole karma, this theory can be associated with consciousness. It is very similar to the TDVP model. Consciousness can influence matter energy in different ways. Now, Labdhis and Siddhis, which are being discussed in our literature, they are like that. So through this, you can explain the physical, you can influence the physical processes also. then consciousness, life can exist without matter, DNA and RNA. And we have this concept of Devi Devtas, for example. So they don't carry physical body, but they can exist. So mysticism can be explained using higher dimensions. They talk of higher dimensions, the two additional dimensions of time and consciousness. So they can be explained using these things. So, in the same way, as I told you, and the last, which was actually raised by Madam, COVID-19 and lessons. These are the lessons now. We have to change the current model of science. There is no way out. And Jainism can help a lot in giving new directions to the current science. And I am making this statement very seriously as a scientist of ISRO. ISRO scientists, when talk something, it is taken seriously. So science has come to a stage where we have to give some new dimension, new direction to the whole thing. Last, for example, though, again, this is what is known as Cambridge Declaration on Consciousness. Cambridge University called a conference in 2012 of 100 top neurologists of the world. And they just came out with that declaration known as Cambridge Declaration. It says that small insects also have consciousness. They just, unanimously made an announcement about it. Now, this is the same thing which our acharyas and our Tirthankaras are talking from thousands of years ago. So now, the final, just one slide only, that what to do now. So what to do is how to save the planet Earth. And to save the planet Earth, we have to celebrate International Non-Violence Day. So much violence activities are going on all over the world. So many arms and ammunitions are getting, terrorist activities, and so many nonsense things are going on. All these violence things have to be reduced, have to be cut down. So United Nations has given an opportunity, just like International Yoga Day, United Nations has approved that October 2 should be celebrated as International Non-Violence Day, and they have done it in 2007. But many Jains also, actually, they don't know. Now, this is the time that we celebrate, we take a decision that we let us celebrate this International Non-Violence Day and spread the message of Ahimsa in the whole world, in all the 200 countries, make a plan for it and try to move in the direction of saving the Earth. That is for our children and grandchildren. So that is the thing, and I want to end here. I apologize, I have taken more time, but this is my habit to, because we may meet, we may not meet. So I want to give as much as possible. You can see the slides and we can interact also afterwards. So thank you very much to all the organization and Samniji and you audience for listening to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pokharna. And it was an amazing lecture. It is such a wonder that our Jain Shastras has so much knowledge. And sometimes being a normal common person like me, it is beyond our perspective to even think how all these things are related together and how these way of life, I don't call it religion as Jainism, I call it way of life.
Yes.
And based on way of life, yes, based on way of life, the things that we learn every time in these lectures is beyond our capacity sometimes. And thank you so much for your time. I know the time constraint is only 1.5 hours, but thank you for keeping in perspective with the time. And we are going to open for question and answers. So please raise your hand in the chat. And I'm also going to put, Dr. Pokharna, if you allow me, can I put your email? So if anybody has question and answers after the time is done, they can ask you personally. Is that okay? Okay, sure. So go ahead and ask your question. Please raise your hand. And I see Rajmalji Jain has, thank you for joining us, Rajmalji. And go ahead and ask your question.
Yes. Yeah. very nice talk, Professor Pokharna. Very nice. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Can you hear me? Meri awaaz aa rahi hai?
Yes. Aa rahi hai, awaaz aa rahi hai.
Okay, very good. It was very nice, magnificent talk. I wish to know what is the difference or how the two things are associated, One is the space point, Akash Pradesh, and one is the Atma Pradesh, the soul point. So what is the difference and how these two things are connected with each other? Space point and soul point. Akash Pradesh or Atma Pradesh. Ye dono kaise, inme kya difference hai ya kaise ek jaise hain ya kaise jude hue hain?
There is a difference. Actually, I am also trying to understand it. But they are different. Actually, they are different.
At least, do you know the space point is smaller or a soul point? Akash Pradesh chota hai ya Atma Pradesh chota hai?
I think Atma Pradesh is smaller. I am still trying to get, actually for my project and for my thesis, I am trying to compare all these six substances and their different attributes. So there also, I am facing this type of problem that what is the relation between the two? But I think they are different.
No, because my question was in the context, you told about the TDVP model, that is nine-dimension model you are talking.
Right.
But in Jainism, anything which can be explained requires 12 dimension. Number one, dravya, kshetra, kal, or bhav. Bhav means consciousness.
We cannot compare those 12.
No. Please, let me complete. Let me complete my question. Please keep patience. So all these four things, that is matter, akash, that is space, time, and consciousness. And each one has three dimensions. So that is 12 dimension. And you were talking, I heard, theory of everything, something like that. And for theory of everything, you need these 12 dimensions to come into a singularity, that is man, that is mind, body, and consciousness. Then only your avdhi gyan is possible. So, and you are talking only nine dimensions at the moment. So,
When we are comparing these nine dimensions with those 12 dimensions, we have to be very careful about what is the definition of those nine dimensions and what is the definition of the 12 dimensions. For example, one of my friend, Dr. Manohar Kalra, he was telling that in that Kashmiri Shiv Math also, they are talking of some dimensions, Amina. So we have to examine critically what is the meaning of those dimensions, in which context we are talking.
I think my time is limited or not, but it is written already in Jainism and you are comparing with the Jainism. You compare TDVP model on the left side, on the right side, Jainism model.
Agreed. Yeah. But I am not comparing the dimensions, that what are those nine dimensions and what are those 12 dimensions. That needs to be compared. Yeah, but I have not done that comparison up till now. But it should be done.
No, I mean, if you have not compared anyway, it may be your future project. But I mean, if we are saying that it is at par with the Jainism, then you see, we should talk the complete Jainism thing. Because avdhi gyan is not possible and keval gyan by any means it is not possible unless you have that singularity. Anyway, thank you very much. It was a nice talk. Excellent.
Thank you, Rajmalji, for a great question. And thank you, Dr. Pokharna, for answering that. We have Dr. Kirti Jain, who had asked question in the chat, but I would like Kirti uncle to ask directly the question to Dr. Pokharna.
Sure.
Uncle, unmute yourself. Unmute yourself, please.
Unmute you, Mara.
I'm going to ask Kirti uncle's question. If you don't mind, Kirti uncle, I don't know what's the problem going on with your microphone. So his question was, how should we go about giving direction to science and have the scientists take Jain principles seriously, as it is a tall challenge?
Yes, that is an excellent question. Actually, as I told you, the first conference on science and Jainism was held in 1975. And afterwards, there are many organizations who are working in this direction. There is one Gyan Sagar Foundation. Actually, they organized about 4 conferences. And Jain Vishwa Bharati has also arranged 2 or 3 conferences. And we have the proceedings of those conferences available with us, actually. So they can act as the starting material. And then in India, we have started one Jain Academy of Scholars. So this Jain Academy of Scholars is constituted to actually take up this problem at how science can be given direction by Jainism, for example. So this is one of the projects. And from last 3 months, I think a series of lectures is going on Jain cosmology, for example, and how this Jain cosmology is similar or different from the modern cosmology. Dr. Rajmalji Jain is also actually planning to give a lecture on this. About 4 lectures have already been held. So now we are focusing on this particular area. And then they will take up some other areas. We are trying to make some groups. And each group will take up one project or one activity, which just actually link the two. For example, I am interested in taking up the problem of consciousness. And I am very, very pretty sure that Jain literature can provide new directions and new concepts to the problem of consciousness. I am pretty sure about it.
Thank you, Dr. Pokharna. Uncle, your microphone is started, so go ahead and ask your second question, Dr. Kirti Jain.
Well, just as a follow-up to the first question, there's been a mini explosion of academic departments on Jain studies in U.S. We already have 20-plus departments in different universities. And I like Steve to chime in as well as to how can we make use of these departments. One, in creating a common stage all over the world to put all the academicians together on some stage. And secondly, to connect them to the scientific community.
Right. Actually, we need to develop a program for this. We had one meeting the day before yesterday about how to proceed further. So we were talking about forming a group, and they may be at international level, for example. So each group will consist of scientists as well as Jain scholars. So Jain scholars will provide what is mentioned in Agmas about a particular thing. So for example, we have 32 Agmas. Now, out of 32 Agmas, suppose we take one topic, say Jain cosmology. Now, how many of these 32 Agmas are covering different aspects of Jain cosmology? Let us put it together. Then we have another this constituent of scientists who are from, say, the theory of relativity group, for example, who are working in the field of cosmology, for example, or cosmology. So let them interact, freely. And let there be interaction among the two groups, and then let us see what actually can be done. For example, the problem of dark matter, dark energy, it is not solvable at all. Now, maybe that there is some connection of the dark matter, dark energy with dharmastika and adharmastika. We don't know on it. So these are the areas which are question marks. So we have to identify the problems which are there in science, and we have to find out some good material which is there in Agmas, which can provide some help.
Any thoughts, Steve?
Well, it sounds like that project just requires scientists to use people like me as a series of reference manuals. And so if they could read Proker themselves, they wouldn't need us.
Yes.
And so, I mean, I'd be happy to teach any number of scientists Prakrit, like that would be fine, but like you're not actually listening to our perspective just by using us as reference manuals. And so I guess the question for me is what is the purpose of finding out whether or not dark matter and dharmastika is and akashastika is have anything to do with each other? It seems to me like that's actually a deflection of the meaningful question, which is how do we get moksha? And describing space is an important aspect of Jainism, and certainly having a materialist understanding of the universe requires you to understand it all the way down to its subtlest forms, as well as its most complex wholes. But essentially what you're missing, and I was noting this, especially in your sort of truth A to B to C to D, is that somewhere between creating a general theory or something like that in science and then moving it onto the technology sphere and then from technology into industry, somewhere along that way, we actually need an ethical intervention to say, okay, we could make this product, but should we? Will this actually make our lives better? And will it ultimately end up in truth D, which is the environmental degradation, right? Which most people would say as well, industry is the end and environmental degradation is just a terrible byproduct and that's just too bad. So taking seriously, as you put it, right, the idea. Yeah, and so I think that the difference between science and religion is the difference between fact and truth. And if science can tell us all sorts of facts about the world and sort of theoretical facts, but truth is sort of a different thing. And so religion and philosophy and especially ethics, I think, are
ultimately,
really...
ultimately, you have to understand. No, the whole problem is that the current science, the type of science which is being done as on today, this is more and more materialistic in nature. That is what Deepak Chopra and this... Rupert Sheldrake, they are talking about, I mean. Because now what the people are economically driven science. Because, for example, I mean, the funding agency will decide which type of science should be taken out or it should be carried out. I mean, the funding agency, multinational companies who have a lot of funds. So they have given a direction to the science. So what has happened in this process is that we have moved away from the our inquisitiveness to understand the nature. Instead of that, the science has shifted towards more and more materialistic, and it has now been linked with economy and other aspects, actually. So that line has to be drawn, actually, Amira.
Absolutely,
and that is coming in the way. Many of the scientists, Western scientists, I have talked to them, they admit in private that this is not a healthy trend, but they are helpless. That is the biggest issue which is coming in the way of doing good science. And science and religion, these are, again, these two terms have been defined, but nature actually doesn't say that I am science and I am religion. No. So this is also man-made, that this is religion and this is science. This difference was not there, I think, in the past, maybe in East or in West.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pokarna, for that amazing knowledge. Thank you, Steve. And just with the conclusion of your lecture, how the last slide said that plan of action. And again, it's an individual effort on each of us to create that kind of plan of action within ourselves, within our area of expertise, or whatever enterprise we are in, wherever we are in, what are we doing from on our behalf? What step are we taking? Do we have a plan of action for ourselves? How many people are we as educators? And I know as educators, doctors, professionals, all of us, we do reflect so many people around us in this environment. So how many people are we reflecting these kind of knowledge, what we get from here and going back to the community? So thank you so much, Dr. Pokarna, for your time. And thank you all our audience, the new ones and all the old ones that has been—
Actually, I will just end it with one more comment from you. As you mentioned, we are organizing a 6 days webinar to celebrate this International Nonviolence Day, and there are 25 speakers will be there, and we have invited about 12 persons who are actually implementing the concept of ahimsa in their real life, daily life. So I mean those of you who want to really understand meaning of ahimsa, they can join that webinars. I mean, I can pass on that circular to you. And as far as I am concerned, as you know, this after Corona, that is March, there are about 20 to 25 dogs are there around my house. Okay. And there are cows are there, for example. So I was feeding them. I should not say from my mouth, but I am telling you that I am 70 years old and the government has put restriction that we should not go out and all those things. But I believe in the power of consciousness and soul. And that has given me a direction that I should go and help those dogs and those cows to feed them. So every day I am going there and I am doing that thing, Matlab. And now people are supporting me. And many individuals are also doing it here. So we have to set the examples. We have to set the examples and then transfer and communicate those the ideas of those examples on a large scale. I mean, that is the only way. Then please, please, please see that we have to look at our children. Please look at our children, what type of world we want to give them. What type of world our parents had given to us 50 years or 60 years ago. And what type of world we want to give it to our children. That will decide this whole question. That is my urge to you, sincere urge to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pokharna, on behalf of JERF, JCCF. Thank you so much for your time and your amazing lecture. I would ask Shramiji to say a few words about her futuristic plan.
Thank you, Larry.